No, no, not Arabia. June 29th, 1940. Italy declared war on France 19 days ago and last week launched an offensive into French territory. This week, we'll see how that turned out. I'm Indy Neidell. This is World War II. Last week, the Soviet Union occupied Latvia, Estonia, and Lithuania and toppled their governments. In China, a major battle came to an end as Japan won the Battle of Zhaoyang Yisheng. The Italians began an invasion of France, while the French signed an armistice to end hostilities with the Germans. Also, Philippe Pétain became Prime Minister of France last week. Pierre Laval is appointed Deputy Prime Minister this week. On the 23rd, French Defense Minister Maxime Weygand officially cashiers General Charles de Gaulle. De Gaulle has been in Britain urging the French to fight on by radio. The British recognize de Gaulle as leader of the Free French.
J'invite tous les Français qui veulent rester libres à m'écouter et à me suivre. Vive la France, libre dans l'honneur et dans l'indépendance.
Also the 23rd, Adolf Hitler visits Paris. It is his first trip there. He's taken around famous buildings, and while there, he orders the destruction of two World War monuments, a statue of French General Charles Magin and a memorial to British nurse Edith Cavell. When he will eventually get back to Berlin in July, he will have Albert Speer draw up a decree to resume work on monuments and public buildings there that stopped last September with the invasion of Poland. Hitler vows to make Berlin more beautiful than Paris, with the new Berlin completed by 1950. This week, he also visits where he served on the Western Front in World War I. On the 24th, the French former government ministers, who had headed to North Africa to hopefully continue the fight from there, arrive there to find that the Governor General has already accepted the armistice with Germany. So that's not going to happen. And on the 25th, France officially surrenders to Germany. That same day sees the final British troops evacuated from French ports, the close of Operation Ariel, during which 191,870 Allied soldiers, airmen, and civilians had escaped France. Last week I mentioned that the British were also evacuating the Channel Islands, and this week those islands are bombed. The British had demilitarized them, but the Germans are unaware of that. In Guernsey, 33 people are killed and 67 injured, and on Jersey, 9 are killed. So the active war continues between Germany and Britain, but so does that between France and Italy, at least early in the week. I talked last week about the Italian Alpine offensive, and the week ended with the French holding their ground. This week, it's a bit of an anti-climax there. There is sporadic fighting the first couple days of the week, but the Italian Alpine Corps cannot reach Bourg Saint-Maurice, and the 1st Army Corps advances on Moudon but cannot reach it. On the coast, the Italian 1st Army does take Menton, a pretty good prize, but are nowhere near their goal of Nice when an armistice is signed. Yep, on the 23rd, the same French delegation that signed with the Germans the 22nd meets the Italians in Rome. French General Charles Hunziker is again in charge. An armistice is signed at 7:15 p.m. the 24th and goes into effect 12:30. This establishes a demilitarized zone 50 kilometers deep. But the actual Italian occupation zone isn't that big. It includes Menton, but is only 832 square kilometers total area with under 30,000 inhabitants. Of course, the Italians are still at war with the British. On the 28th comes the Battle of the Espero Convoy, the first engagement of the war between Italian and Allied warships. Three Italian destroyers meet the British 7th Cruiser Squadron that was doing convoy protection work in the Mediterranean. One destroyer is sunk, but the cruisers use so much ammunition that convoys to Malta, a British colony, are postponed until it can be replenished. Also the 28th, Marshal Italo Balbo, commander-in-chief of Italian North Africa, is killed by friendly fire at Tobruk, Libya, while flying over during a British raid. Marshal Rodolfo Graziani succeeds him next week. There are other nations that are trying to avoid being at war this week, though. On the heels of occupying the Baltic states last week, the Soviet Union turns its attention to Romania, and on the 26th demands Bessarabia and Bukovina from Romania. The Romanians propose negotiations, but Soviet Foreign Minister Vyacheslav Molotov says the choices are land concessions or war. It's not much of a choice, and on the 28th, the Soviet Red Army occupies Romanian Bessarabia and northern Bukovina. In the U.S., the Republican Party's National Convention is held in Philadelphia this week. Wendell Willkie is chosen as their presidential candidate. The party is overwhelmingly in favor of non-intervention in the war. On the 27th, America's Secretary of State Cordell Hull meets with British and Australian representatives. They ask for help standing up to Japan. They want the U.S. to take economic measures, offer to mediate between China and Japan, or move more of its fleet to Philippine and Malaysian waters. Hull says the U.S. is not prepared for such an active foreign policy at this time. The United States' northern neighbor is, however. This week begins the deportation from Britain to Canada of German and Italian-born people. Many of these are actually Jewish refugees who fled to Britain in the first place. Germany seems to be turning its focus to Britain. On the 27th, the Germans set up radio at Brest and Cherbourg to help guide their bombers to Britain in future. They use Enigma to code the instructions to set up those stations, so the British learn of their existence that same day. On the 28th, Enigma messages tell British intelligence that German long-range bombers will be refitted after France and ready to go by 8th. So a bomber offensive versus Britain in the not-too-distant future is a possibility. Here are a few things I have not yet had time to mention this month. Back on the 4th, Britain took a look at its condition and how it might be able to respond to an invasion force if Germany turned its attention that way, should France fall, as France has now done. Martin Gilbert writes, "There were 500 heavy guns on British soil, some of them museum pieces. On June 4th, the War Cabinet learned that between May 19th and June 1st, 453 aircraft of all types had been produced. In that same period, 436 had been lost. The number of aircraft actually serviceable as of June 2nd was 504. He goes on to say that Sir Hugh Dowding, the head of Fighter Command, had told the War Cabinet that if Germany attacked by air, he could not guarantee air superiority for more than 48 hours. At Dunkirk, again numbers according to Gilbert, the British had left behind 475 tanks, 38,000 total vehicles, 8,000 field telephones, 1,855 field wireless sets, 400 anti-tank guns, 1,000 heavy guns, 8,000 Bren guns, 90,000 rifles, 7,000 tons of ammunition. There are currently fewer than 600,000 rifles and 12,000 Bren guns in Britain." Churchill said recently, though, that even if all of Europe was under the Nazis, whose victories had come because of their machines, that the regime would collapse. Machines will beat machines. Well, the British can count on some machine assistance. Last month, 600 railway cars had deposited the first military supplies authorized by American President Franklin Roosevelt to be soon sent to Britain and France. This included 900 field guns, 80,000 machine guns, and 500,000 rifles. Manufactured back in World War I, okay, but stored in Greece since then. 250 rounds of ammunition was provided for each rifle as well.
"We send forth our prayers and our hopes to those beyond the seas who are maintaining with magnificent valor their battle for freedom."
But Britain is still alone in the actual fight. It's interesting to read different historians' views of how things might have gone had something different happened. They disagree. It is, of course, all just speculation, and we cannot know the answer. Max Hastings wrote this, though, which I thought I'd share. "Modern staff college war games of the 1940 campaign sometimes conclude with German defeat. This causes a few historians to argue that Hitler's triumph on the battlefield might have been averted. it is hard to accept such a view. The Wehrmacht displayed a dynamic energy entirely absent from the 1940 armies. Contrary to popular myth, the Germans did not conquer France in accordance with a detailed plan for Blitzkrieg. Rather, commanders showed inspired opportunism, with results that exceeded their wildest expectations. If the French had moved faster and the Germans more slowly, the outcome of the campaign could have been different, but such an assertion is meaningless. We've talked about this a bunch the past few months, and the Allied defeat was not because of a material inferiority. The German command structure was simple and focused, the Allied was chaotic and cumbersome, and the Allied responses to basically everything the Germans did lacked conviction. With that, I'll wrap up this week of the war. An active war between Britain and Italy, but the end of that between France and Italy. Britain taking stock and wondering if and when a German attack will come, and the Soviet Union again expanding its borders. The world was pretty stunned by Hitler's victory in the West, of course, but no one more so than Joseph Stalin. All of his plans and strategies were based on a long war of attrition in Western Europe, which would, of course, weaken everyone who took part. But this, the USSR is in the middle of a huge rearmament program, but that's going to take a few years to complete. And a long war in the West would have likely prevented any possible showdown between Germany and the USSR. Of course, Germany and the Soviets still have their pact from last year. The German Navy uses Russian ports. The Soviets still send tons of oil and food supplies to Germany. So it would not seem to the German advantage to break that pact. But still, Stalin does not want to provoke Hitler. He is not building big fortifications on his Western border. Instead, he's taking the distraction of the West to increase his territory, first the Baltics and now Bessarabia. But let's put it like this. Hitler attacking in the West had served Stalin's interests. Hitler winning had not. Hard to believe that now in 1940, it's already been 20 years since Stalin and his friends tried to go west themselves, even as far as thinking of conquering Germany. We covered that in Between Two Wars, and you can discover or rediscover it right here. Our Time Ghost Army member of the week is Igor Zinoviev. Do like Igor and make your contribution to keep these videos coming by joining us on Patreon or at timeghost.tv. See you next time.